Welcome to Thursday Dairy Update. This is Kathy Barrett with the Cornell Pro Dairy Program, and the Pro Dairy Program, along with Eastern Dairy Business, is pleased to be able to offer this webinar series. Today's webinar will be presented by Nicole Martin, who is the Associate Director of the Quality Milk Improvement Program here at Cornell University. Her presentation is on keeping it clean for the tank. She's going to be discussing how to reduce spore-forming contaminants in the bulk tank.
I'm the Associate Director of the Milk Quality Improvement Program. Our program is located in the Food Science Department at Cornell, and we are primarily dairy farmer funded through checkoff dollars. So we have a keen interest in dairy production and making sure that we have the best information for dairy producers to create the best product. So today we're going to talk about spore-forming bacteria, and I'm going to start with the bottom line because I just want to make sure that we're all on the same page in case anybody falls asleep during my presentation. We'll still all know what's going on. So the first thing, bacterial endospores, and these are bacteria that produce spores, and I'll talk a little bit more about the structure of these organisms and what they do. But we know that they play an important role in meeting customer specifications in dairy powders. We also know that they play an important role in dairy product spoilage and defects that can create consumer dissatisfaction and unwillingness to buy. We also know that controlling these organisms in dairy powders and in other dairy products begins on the dairy farm. So these are one of the only bacterial contaminants in the raw milk and dairy product chain that originate from the farm and can survive pasteurization and other processing technologies and end up in the final product. So they're present in dairy environments. They originate from soil and water and plant material, and they're able to get into the bulk tank raw milk through a number of transmission pathways. These are associated, these different spore types, which we'll talk about in a minute, are associated with different on-farm sources. So some of them can originate from feed, some of them can originate from water, but when we're looking at the different types that affect different dairy products, we're generally looking at different sources. Finally, we know that farm management practices are associated with levels of psychrotolerant, mesophilic, and thermophilic spores in bulk tank raw milk. And these are just words for where the bacteria likes to grow, so either at low temperatures, at mid-range temperatures, or at high temperatures. And we'll talk a little bit more about that as I go through my slides. So this is a bacterial endospore, and I'm going to grab the pointer here real quick. I think I've got it. There we go. So this is a bacterial cell here, and inside you can see this endospore, what I'll refer to throughout the presentation as a spore, which I'll take a moment to clarify. A lot of times we have some confusion because the word spore is used in a variety of different manners, and one way that it's used is for fungal spores. And fungal spores can create a variety of different problems on a dairy farm. They produce different crop diseases, smuts and rusts, and they can produce toxins. But we're talking about bacterial endospores today. So I'm going to use the word spore, but just keep in mind that these are bacterial and not fungal, so not mold spores. And so essentially what happens is this organism, this group of organisms, can create this very resistant structure here that's shown in the center when it senses that it's in an environment that will destroy the cell. So it creates this if it starts to sense that it doesn't have the right nutrients or if the environment is getting too hot, it can create this spore. And it packages all of its genetic information inside of the spore. So in here is all the DNA. And that protects the DNA from being destroyed. So even though the vegetative cell or this outside cell here, what would grow and produce enzymes and spoil products, even if that's destroyed because of the harsh environment, that endospore can survive. And these endospores, oh, I might have to get out of annotation. There we go. So they're formed under stressful environmental conditions. Like I said, if the cell senses that it's going to be destroyed by the environment, it can produce this spore. And that spore is resistant to a number of lethal hazards for what would be lethal to the bacteria. So heat, for instance, pasteurization or drying, which is an environment it would encounter in dairy powders, radiation, sanitizers, these spores are extraordinarily resistant. And in fact, we know that they can survive in environments for millions of years. Some scientists have isolated these spores from ice caps that have been encased in ice for millions of years and been able to grow them in a laboratory. So these are extraordinarily resistant and they last indefinitely in the environment. And then the real key to why these organisms are a problem for us and the dairy industry is that under favorable conditions, these spores can then return to an active state. So they can sense that they're in a good place with nutrients and not too hot, not too cold, and they can start growing again. And that's all captured in this, what we call the spore cycle. And so if we go through this just quickly so you can see what happens and why it's an issue for dairy products. All right, I'm going to grab the annotation tool again. If we start here, this is a vegetative cell. This is a bacterial cell that can grow and multiply. It can produce enzymes. It can spoil product. It can create biofilms. It's just doing its normal thing that all bacteria like to do. So this is called the vegetative cycle. It's growing, it's splitting, and it does this as long as it has nutrients and can survive in that environment. The cell starts to notice that something in its environment is going to destroy it, and so it goes through this sporulation cycle. So it starts these series of steps where it produces this endospore. And you can see this is a fairly complex biology that I'm not going to go into, but this spore that it creates is essentially a 7-layer protein coat around its genetic information. And eventually we get over here to this free spore. And so this free spore is what can survive in environments indefinitely. And they're extraordinarily common pretty much everywhere. So that organism then can survive in its environment just in this inactive state, and then as soon as it notices that it can grow again, it goes back into this vegetative cycle. And so you can imagine that this is an issue for the dairy industry because we have these spores, they're present in the environment, they get into the raw milk on the dairy farm, and then they can survive pasteurization, and then in some products they can start to grow because they have plenty of nutrients, they like the storage temperatures, and then they can spoil a product or cause defects. All right, so what are the relevant spore-forming bacteria products? The first one that we're very concerned with, and we've been studying for the last 20 years in my program, are psychrotolerant spore formers. And the word psychrotolerant just means these bacteria can survive and grow at low temperatures or refrigeration temperatures. And in fluid milk, these are the organisms that are causing spoilage when the product hasn't been contaminated after pasteurization. And what we know from studying this for a number of years is that about 50% of fluid milk spoilage is due to these psychrotolerant spore formers. And the predominant ones that we understand spoil fluid milk are Penibacillus, Viridibacillus, and Bacillus weinsteffanensis. They comprise the most of the spore formers that spoil fluid milk. And if we look at how they spoil fluid milk, this is just a graph of how bacteria grow over time. And so, I just want to make sure you guys can see this. So if we look at spore-forming bacteria over time, so this axis is time, 17 days of refrigerated storage. And here on the y-axis is just how many bacteria that we have. And so we start out with a really low level, somewhere around 10 cells per mil, extraordinarily low. In gram-positive fluid milk spoilage, what happens is over the first 10 days, we don't see a whole lot of growth. It's pretty stagnant. But then between 10 and 17 days, and sometimes a little longer, 21 days, we start to see pretty rapid growth. And that's because that cell has to come out of the spore stage and start growing again. And it takes it a little bit of time because it's a pretty low temperature. And if you contrast that with a post-processing contaminant like Pseudomonas that's been reintroduced into the milk after it's been pasteurized, that starts to grow very rapidly after pasteurization or after the contamination and reaches extraordinarily high levels. And if we talk about differences in shelf life, milk that's been contaminated after pasteurization spoils within 7 to 10 days. Milk that's been contaminated with gram-positive spore formers at the farm level usually reaches spoilage levels somewhere after 14, around 17 days post-processing. The next group that are particularly interesting to the dairy industry are called anaerobic butyric acid bacteria. And that simply is indicative of the fact that these organisms grow in the absence of oxygen. They can't grow under aerobic conditions. And they produce butyric acid. And the organisms that we know of that cause this defect are Clostridium tirebutyricum, Clostridium butyricum, and Clostridium sporogenes. And actually, there are a number of other Clostridium species that will grow and produce this defect. And essentially what happens is the low levels of these spores get into the milk that's made into cheese, and over a 60-day aging period, we start to see this defect show up, and it's called light blowing because the cheese literally blows up. And you can see the on top of this photo, the cheese that has these spores in it, and the control cheese that didn't have the spores in it are sitting underneath of these. And you can see how the product has just literally expanded because there's been so much gas production. And this is very economically damaging for cheese processors because they've put in a lot of time and money into processing this cheese and then aging it and storing it for 60 days, and then it suddenly blows up and becomes unsalable. So they're very interested in preventing this defect. And in fact, this defect has historically been associated with high levels of butyric acid bacteria in silage. And we know that in Europe, in countries where they make a lot of cheese that is susceptible to this defect, in some countries there are penalties for having too high levels of these spores in the raw milk. And in some countries you can't even use, for example, in Switzerland, you can't use milk, raw milk, for this style of cheese that's come from cows that were fed silage because of this historical association with silage. So this is a really important defect, and one of the oldest that we've known of that is tied to spore-forming bacteria. And then finally, dairy powders have become an extraordinarily important source of economic growth in our country because of the export market to international customers for these products. And in dairy powders, we're mostly concerned with mesophilic and thermophilic spore formers. And these, again, are just the ones that grow at sort of a mid-range temperature and a high-range temperature. So meso means mid and thermo means high heat. And so these organisms like to be in dairy powders because dairy powder processing typically runs at much higher temperatures than fluid milk processing or cheese processing. And we know that the main spore-forming bacteria that are present in dairy powders are Bacillus lichenoformis, Geobacillus, and Enoxybacillus. And the real issue here is that international customers, and this graph is from the U.S. Dairy Export Council, who works with exporting dairy powders, the issue is that international customers typically have pretty stringent specifications for spores in dairy powders and in specifically infant formulas. And I've seen specifications all the way down to 40 spores per gram of dairy powder, up to over 1,000. So it's a pretty broad range, but making powder with this low spore count is challenging and has been a challenge for the U.S. dairy industry. So I'll take a moment just to introduce some of the tests that we use because I'm going to talk more about specific types of spore-forming bacteria, and I want to make sure that we're all on the same page about how we test for these organisms. And there are a variety of different tests. In fact, there are hundreds of different tests that we can do for spore-forming bacteria, but I've tried to represent sort of the major groups of tests that we can do. But they all have some similarities, and the first being that there's a heat treatment at the beginning. And that heat treatment is really designed to eliminate any vegetative cells. So any cells that aren't in the spore form are destroyed during this heat treatment. And it can be anything from 80 degrees C for 12 minutes or even a little bit lower than that, all the way up to 106 degrees C for 30 minutes. And if you notice, that's above boiling, the boiling temperature of water. So that's actually done in a pressurized vessel. And we call that a specially heat-resistant spore treatment. And this treatment was designed by a dairy powder company in New Zealand and has since become the ISO method for testing dairy powders for spore-forming bacteria. And then the second step that happens in a spore test is the incubation temperature. So we heat treat our raw milk or our dairy powders or whatever we're looking at, and then we put a portion of that milk onto an auger plate, and then we put that into an incubator for 2 days. Or if we're looking for low temperature living spores, we might do it for longer. And that incubator temperature will select for certain groups. So the psychrotolerant spores that I mentioned earlier that spoil fluid milk, when we want to detect those, we have to hold that product at 6 degrees C. So that's refrigeration temperature. And we have to hold it for a long time because it takes these guys a while to come out of their spore phase and start growing again. And so we hold that for 10 days. Or we can do a mesophilic test, which is done, again, at sort of a mid-range temperature, 32 degrees C. That's just below body temperature. Or we can do a thermophilic test, which is at 55 degrees C. And both of those mesophilic and thermophilic tests are for 48 hours. And that's just how we enumerate. That's how we count how many spores are in a product. And lastly, all the way over, you'll see the butyric acid bacteria test. And this one's a little bit different. It still shares the fact that there's an initial heat treatment, but it's a little different because we don't put the product onto a plate and then count how many colonies there are. We stick the product into different tubes. We cap it with a wax compound, and then we count how many produce gas. And then we have a formula that tells us how many spores were in the original milk if we do this process. And that's an industry standard for that test. There are a lot of different tests, and in the industry right now, like I said, there are hundreds of different combinations that can be used to test for spores. And what we know about these different tests is they select for different types of spore-forming bacteria, and so you can get very different results based on which test you are using. So spore-forming bacteria can come from two different places. The image here is of Penicillin, so if you'll remember, that's the spore that grows at refrigeration temperatures and spoils fluid milk. But it's true for all spores. They can come either from the dairy farm environment or they can come from the processing environment. And we're going to focus just on the dairy farm environment today for this presentation. So we know that these organisms create defects in cheese and fluid milk and dairy powders. They're important. We know that they can come from raw milk, so we know they're present in raw milk and on the farm. And in the most recent study that we did, we took another step back and looked at the farm environment. But for the first section here, let's just focus on what do we know is in the raw milk from the studies that we've done. And like I mentioned earlier, we've been studying this issue for the last 20 years, so we have a lot of data. In the raw milk, what we know is that these organisms are prevalent at different proportions. So essentially, mesophilic spores are almost always present in raw milk. And that you can see, let me just grab the pointer here. From this graph, mesophilic spores are present in raw milk 100% of the times we test it. So they're always there. They're the most prevalent. Thermophilic spores, these TSCs here, are present almost all of the time, but this little tiny black box up here means that they were present at such a low level that we couldn't detect them using our tests. So almost 100% of the time, but not quite. Psychrotolerant spores spores, on the other hand, those ones that grow at refrigeration temperatures, are represented here in this graph. And essentially what this is just a really long incubation period, so 21 days of refrigerated storage, and we monitored if the raw milk that we had used and heat treated, if there were any spores there that would grow at low temperatures. And what we found was that about 60% of the samples had spores that would grow over 21 days, so this line here. And you can see it's that same sort of pattern, not much growth over the first 7 days, and then it starts to grow pretty rapidly. But the other proportion of the samples that we took had this growth curve, which means that there were no cycotolerant spores in that portion of milk that we took from a bulk tank. So there is raw milk, a fairly high percentage of raw milk, that have such low levels of cycotolerant spores in it that it can last for 21 days without showing any growth. And that's really exciting to us because we know that fluid milk processors want to have longer shelf life. They want to reach new markets and be able to ship this product. They want their consumer to have a good experience with their product, and so they don't want it to spoil in 14 days. They want their consumer to be able to consume the product without having issues with it. So that's very exciting to us that nearly 40% of the samples that we tested had such low levels that nothing grew over 21 days. When we look at the actual numbers, so not proportion, not percentage of samples that have these organisms, but the actual numbers of bacteria in the bulk tank raw milk, what we see, and again, this is just, I'm just grabbing the pointer here. This is just level of bacteria over here, and it's a log scale, so 1 is equal to 10 cells per mil, 2 is equal to 100 cells per mil. But essentially what this graph shows us is when we look at different types of spore-forming bacteria, these are the cycotolerant ones, the low-temperature growing ones, mesophilic, thermophilic. These ones here are the highly heat-resistant thermophilic and then specially thermoresistant. And then this bar here is the butyric acid bacteria. What we know is that these organisms are all present in extraordinarily low levels in bulk tank raw milk. And this is a big challenge for the industry because if you have a lot of them, it's easy to detect them. It's easy to start coming up with strategies to eliminate them. But when there are very few, it actually makes it more challenging to remove them. And what I find particularly interesting here are these butyric acid bacteria. So those spores are actually present in less than 1 per mil of raw milk. So very, very low levels. But we know that as few as 1 per liter of raw milk can cause that late blowing defect. And so it's really important that we have very low levels of these ones here. When we look at the types of spore formers that we find in raw milk, what we see consistently time after time is that Bacillus lichenoformis accounts for almost 50% of the population of spores in bulk tank raw milk. And that's important for us and for dairy powder processors because that organism accounts for most of the spores that we find in dairy powders, and that account for the levels of the spore formers in dairy powders, which can cause a U.S. processor not to be able to export their product. And so that one is very interesting. If you'll notice the little piece of the pie that says 2% all the way up at the top, that's Penibacillus. That's the one that grows at low temperatures. So we know that those ones are infrequent, and that's consistent with what we know about the fact that 40% of the raw milk that we've tested have shown extraordinarily low levels of Penibacillus, not capable of growing at refrigeration temperature, not capable of spoiling fluid milk over 21 days. So, but you can imagine it's hard to find them when they're there so infrequently and at such low levels. So that's been a challenge in the research that we've done in trying to create diagnostic tools. Okay, so we talked about products, we talked about how many of these things we find in raw milk and what types they are. Now let's move back one step further and look at management practices on the farm that are associated with these organisms and sources of these organisms on the farm. And so what we know from doing a variety of studies where we've looked for different spore-forming bacteria, and done surveys at farms to evaluate if there are any management practices that impact spore levels in raw milk. What we know is that a one-size-fits-all management strategy is not appropriate for reducing these organisms in raw milk. And I'll show you a few bits of data to support that. So when we look at cycle-tolerant spore formers and what management practices are associated with those organisms, we can see that cow hygiene score and herd size impacted it. They actually reduced it, so the bigger the herd size, the lower the spore count. Season impacted it. When we look at mesophilic, there were a variety of other management practices that impacted the levels of mesophilic spores in raw milk, so things like sand bedding and straw bedding and forage stripping. And then when we looked at thermophilic, we found a totally separate set of management practices that impacted spore levels in raw milk. And so this tells us that these organisms are probably originating from different places on the farm, and they're entering into the raw milk in different ways. And so that's important for developing strategies to reduce the level of these organisms in raw milk. The only factor that we found to be the same for all three of these groups of organisms was herd size. And this is a little bit of a tricky one because we don't know exactly what's driving this difference. It could be the fact that as herd size goes up, cows are perhaps being milked more often and there's a dilution effect for the spores in the milk. It could be that larger herd sizes are managed different, or there's different infrastructure. There's a lot of different factors that could go into this. And the problem with doing surveys is that the survey doesn't tell us exactly what is driving these factors. It just tells us which ones are significantly associated. And so what we've done since we've worked on these projects to develop this data is try to understand what's driving these associations. When we look at environmental contaminants, so where these organisms are coming from in the dairy farm environment, what we did was to sample for spores in bedding, in feed, in the housing area. So we looked at water, we looked at manure, we looked at the milking parlor, so the air in the milking parlor, the towels that were used. We did swabs of teats. We did we took samples from individual cows. We took water samples in the parlor. And then we took a bulk tank milk sample, and we also did equipment samples in the bulk tank area. So we tried to take a comprehensive look, and we didn't get all of the samples we'd like to have sampled, but we had some finite hours in the day to do this sampling. So so we tried to do a broad look that would comprehensively capture where spores are in the dairy farm environment. And this is a pretty busy graph, but I'm going to just try to give you some highlights from it. So don't try to capture all the information or to try to absorb all of the information from this graph. But what I'm going to do is point out a few interesting things to take away from it. These are the results of the study where we looked at, let me try to grab my pointer here so I can point some things out. Okay. So the first thing to notice is, again, we have number of bacteria over here on the y-axis, and on the x-axis, we have all of the different sites that we tested on the farm. And again, I'm just color-coding these by the different test types. So we have the cycle-tolerant, the mesophilic, the highly heat-resistant, the thermophilic, and the specially thermoresistant. So that test that's done at under a pressurized environment in order to just select for the most resistant spore formers. And the first thing to notice on this graph is that in some sites on the farm, there are extraordinarily high levels of spore-forming bacteria. And so in particular, manure and soil and bedding over here have very, very high levels of spore-forming bacteria, anywhere in the range of 100,000 to 10 million spores per gram or per mil of whatever we were testing for. So in this case, it was manure, soil, and bedding, so it's per gram. That's a very, very high level of spores. And so that was consistent with every test that we did. So each of these different types of spores all had extraordinarily high levels. Other materials that we tested had lower or mid-range. So the feed sort of had a broad range of spore-forming bacteria, but things like the equipment swabs that we took had very low levels. The T-end had pretty low levels, the towel and the wash water. Something that I find particularly interesting from this study is that if you look here, the air that we tested in the milking parlor actually had registerable levels of spores in it. And that's very interesting to us because we've heard for years from dairy processors that the wind conditions can impact spore levels in products like dairy powders. So processors noticed that on very windy days, their spore counts would go up. And so we're very interested in how wind and air can act as a vehicle to transport spores from their natural environment, which is in things like soil and plant material, into the environment where they can get into bulk tank raw milk. So that one we find very interesting. Here is the bulk tank raw milk, and these numbers are consistent with what I showed you in a couple of slides previous, very low levels, and the ones that were interested in for things like fluid milk here, very, very low levels, but we know that, that's enough to cause 50% of the fluid milk that's being produced to spoil. The next thing I want you to take away from this graph is just that because of these extraordinarily high levels of spores in the environment that the cow is living and eating and being milked in every single day, we can start to realize how much of an impact even a small amount of, let's say, manure that's left on the teat and not cleaned off can have on the bulk tank milk. So if we have, let's say, these mesophilic spores here, that's about a million spores per gram. A gram is not very much. If you had even a fraction of a gram left on every teat while you're cleaning, it can start to add up a lot in the bulk tank milk. So we know that even though these organisms are present in low levels, there can be a huge impact from just a small amount of these materials getting into the milk. If we look closer at just one of the sources, so these are bedding types broken out. So this was all combined in the last graph. But if we look at the various types that we tested, you can see that there's a huge difference based on the type of bedding, all the way from the highest here, so paper, manure, solids, and recycled sand all have very high spore levels in them, but things like sand that hasn't been recycled and sawdust have fairly low levels in comparison. And so this gives us an indication that while it may not be that bedding necessarily gets into the raw milk, if it did, having a different type of bedding would make a big impact on the level of spores in the final product as well. So how are these farm sources related to spores in the actual bulk tank raw milk? We know that they're in the in a variety of sources on the farm, and we know that they're in bulk tank milk. So what are the relationships there? And one of the things that I've been trying to develop and work through is sort of a map of how these different sources interact with each other. And this might be a little busy, but let me grab the pointer here so I can sort of work through it with you. If we start over here at the bulk tank, so that's really what we care about. We care about how many spores are getting into the bulk tank milk. And then we map out how all of the different sources that we tested interact with that bulk tank milk. We can go backward and say that the filter, even though the spores probably aren't coming from the filter, all of the milk goes through the filter and into the bulk tank milk. We can look at the equipment. The equipment could either contribute spores to the bulk tank milk, or the bulk tank milk could contribute spores to the equipment. The wash water could contribute to the equipment, which could then contribute to the bulk tank milk. And then if we go back behind the filter, the teat is really a big coalescence point for all of the other samples that we took to interact with the milk that's coming from the teat. And so the towel touches the teat and the teat touches the towel. Manure might be on the teat, bedding might be on the teat. We might have manure solids bedding, so the manure is interacting with the bedding. Drinking water, feed, soil. So you can see soil's kind of way out here. It's sort of one of those things that may not have a direct impact on the bulk tank milk, but through a variety of other mechanisms, spores may be moving from the soil into the bulk tank milk. And so this is a fairly complex series of relationships, and this certainly may not be comprehensive, but it starts to give us an idea of how these different sources and sites interact with each other. And then down here we have air, because we know air is everywhere. It can pick up, you know, bedding, it can pick up feed, it can pick up soil and move it from one place to another. So that one is a big wild card as far as understanding how it interacts with all of these different sites. And so what we found from the analysis of the data that we collected during this study is that these different spores, so the psychotolerant ones, the mesophilic ones, the thermophilic ones, are associated with different on-farm sources. And this is a polar graph, and it looks a little busy, but we'll break it down into some different test types. Essentially, what it shows us is how much of an association is there between each individual test type. So let's say a psychotolerant spore in a source on the farm, and how associated it with the bulk tank milk is it? So it starts to show us how important each of these sources are to the bulk tank milk when we look at each individual test. And we'll look at some examples here over the next slides. So the first example is highly heat resistant spores. And remember, these are ones that we find in dairy powders. So they survive very high heat treatments, and they can persist in dairy powders. And when we look at these, the highly heat resistant spores that we found in the sites that we tested in the environment and the ones that we found in the bulk tank milk, we found associations between those that are in bedding and in the bulk tank milk and those that are in the equipment in the bulk tank milk. And this doesn't necessarily tell us, like I said, which direction this is going. This could be that the milk is actually influencing the equipment, not necessarily that the equipment is influencing the milk, but it does tell us that they're highly associated. So when we find high levels in the equipment, we're going to find high levels in the milk and vice versa. And this study we recently completed, but we are still working on data analysis for it. So these are just the beginning stages of understanding all of the data that we collected, and we'll have a lot more to share in the coming months. If we look at the butyric acid bacteria, so those are the ones that cause the late blowing defect in certain styles of cheese, we find that they're associated with the teat, with soil, and with the drinking water for the cows. So very different from what we found from the highly heat resistant ones. And then finally, if we look at psychotolerant spores, again, these are the ones that grow at low temperatures and can spoil fluid milk. We find associations with air, manure, and the filter sock. And so again, this means when we find high levels of psychotolerant spores in manure, we found a significant association with high levels in the bulk tank raw milk. And so just as an example, this may mean for producers whose milk is going into a fluid product, they need to focus a lot more on making sure that manure isn't getting into the raw milk than, say, someone who's got a product that's going to cheese making. So this starts to give us an idea of how we can focus on the environment and optimize for low spore count raw milk. So just as a summary, when we're talking about controlling these organisms in raw milk, we know that management practices can be optimized to reduce the level of spores in bulk tank raw milk. We know it's not a one-size-fits-all approach, so the management practices that affect cyclotolerant spores in bulk tank raw milk are tremendously different from the management practices that impact highly heat-resistant spores or thermophilic spores. The only factor that we found that was significantly associated with lower levels of cyclotolerant, mesophilic, and thermophilic spores in bulk tank raw milk was herd size. And again, like I said, it's hard to know exactly why that is from a survey, but the survey gives us the information we need to look into this further. So it could be a number of different issues that impact why we see this as a significant association. And then we know that different types of spores in bulk tank raw milk are associated with different sources on the farm. As we just looked at the associations between air and cyclotolerant spore formers and the TEND and butyric acid bacteria. So we know that there are different areas to focus on based on the end use of the dairy product. And so with that, I'd like to acknowledge the National Dairy Council that funded part of this work, the New York State Milk Promotion Advisory Board. Both of those organizations use dairy farmer checkoff dollars for funding research and promotion for dairy products. And so so all of this comes back to the producers. The New York Farm Viability Institute, which funded the work on the environmental sources for spore formers, the staff and students at the Milk Quality Improvement Program and the Food Safety Laboratory who did all of the hard work of collecting samples and processing samples for these projects, and of course all of the participating producers who've worked with us over the last few years to create this data. There's been a couple of hundred farms that have participated in this work, and so we're very grateful to them for their time and their cooperation in generating this information. I would love to take any questions if there are any.
And you know, Nicole, we have a small enough group that if you would just like to unmute yourself and ask the question, that'd be fine, or you can go ahead and use the chat box. We'll give folks a couple of minutes to type
sure.
in if they do have a question. Nicole, maybe you could comment on economic incentives for producers to kind of take a look at this and think about how they can make some changes.
Sure. So at this point, spore-forming bacteria on the processing side have been a pretty big focus for a number of years, and we haven't seen in the U.S. at this point that processors have started offering incentives to producers to create low spore powder raw milk. And honestly, that's kind of a good thing because we don't have a concrete set of recommendations for producing low spore count raw milk. As I've presented today, we know that there are a lot of associations. And the next steps for us in the research are really to test our theories about intervention strategies and give producers a firm set of recommendations in order to reduce the spore levels in their product. But we do see in the next few years that producers will start to be offered incentives to produce this low spore count raw milk. And primarily, I think that's probably going to come first from cheese makers because this defect, the late blowing defect in cheese, is such a economic burden to them that they're very interested in procuring raw milk with low levels of butyric acid bacteria in them. But certainly we've had a lot of interest also from dairy powder processors, because again, the economic incentive to have a very low spore count raw milk supply is pretty great for them, because they can then export to customers who are willing to pay a much higher rate for the product in order to have a very low spore count powder. So these are things that at this point aren't a reality. They're happening in other parts of the country, other parts of the world. But I do see them coming to the U.S. in the next couple of years, and we will want producers to have the tools that they need in order to make that product.
Nicole, we do have one question. If you would read it out, because not everyone sees it.
So the question is, so from the showing high thermophilic counts, what have you found to be one of the main sources of the counts? So for thermophiles, we do know that the levels of these organisms, like I showed, are pretty consistently low, but they're almost always there. And if I can just go back to the management practice slide here, we can look at that a little closer. So if we look at this, we know that certain practices are associated with higher or lower levels in the raw milk. But we also know that we have very high levels of these organisms showing up in the environment, as I showed you. And so as far as the sources themselves that are associated, we see things like bedding and T-end associated with the thermophilic spore counts. And really, as we move toward developing recommendations for intervention strategies to reduce the numbers of thermophilic spores and others that are getting into the raw milk, what we need to look at is what makes sense from a practical standpoint. How do we prevent the entry of these organisms into the raw milk? And in my opinion, and what we'll test in the next study, and if I can just go back to my map here, is that the teat is really one of the main intervention points that we can look at. And what we hope to do is test a few different methods of milking time hygiene. How stringent does it have to be in order to really significantly reduce the levels of these organisms that are getting into the raw milk?
This is Kathy Barrett again. And on behalf of the Pro Dairy Program and Dairy Business, I'd like to thank you for taking the time to view this webinar.